On January 28, 2009 is when the Unique Identification Authority of India was created. 10 years later, Aadhaar is shaping all our lives, with or without our consent. Well, mostly without our consent, or rather, as Reetika says in the book, with forced consent.
You and me, hosh me aao,
hosh me aao, hosh me aao.
Toh Aadhaar ka jaal nahi chalega. Cheez ke upar itni paabandi ho jaati hai.
Koi cheez le jao, koi nahi de.
सारी चीजें आधार से जोड़ते रहे, और तो आधार के बिना व्यक्ति जो है वो पूरी तरह से निराधार हो जाए.
आधार may actually be making things worse for poor people as far as welfare is concerned. It's created new hurdles that didn't exist before. So earlier, if you think of getting a ration card or a pension sanctioned, if you think of it as a hurdle race, you had to figure out what scheme exists, whether you're eligible, what is the paperwork you need, and so on and so forth. And then at the end of it, you reach the finishing line. Today, what the government has done at that finishing line, it said, okay, now you jump over 3 more hurdles. Get an Aadhaar number, get it linked to your, whichever registry. And then in some cases, they're also saying do monthly biometric authentication. And at each of those steps, people are tripping up. There are bedridden people who had an accident before 2009 who cannot get it. There are people with bad biometrics who can't get it. People who can't see who haven't been able to get it. So it's really hitting the most marginalized.
We're all along told that Aadhaar is going to eliminate ghost beneficiaries, non-existent people, while helping the poor identify themselves better. But clearly the opposite seems to be happening, where the police has busted a gang which has been using fake biometrics to create ghost Aadhaar cards, while real people aren't able to authenticate themselves.
What is done basically is what I call the ultimatum method. You say, okay, from 31st October 2018, pensions will be paid only through Aadhaar linked bank accounts. And then after that, the pension payments stopped. That is what happened in Jharkhand, and I'm quite certain in many other places, perhaps even across the whole country. So those who are not able to meet the requirements by the time of the deadline lose their pensions. We know for a fact that many Narega workers have lost their job cards in the process, and of course in Jharkhand especially, and also some other states, many people have also lost their ration cards because they were not able to link their ration card with Aadhaar in good time.
In the case of welfare, how is it that people still buy this idea that biometric authentication is going to stop quantity fraud? Why are people being made to go and put their thumbprint every month when we know that whether the person signs in a register or whether she puts her thumbprint in a machine, if the dealer is corrupt, he can still give only 32 kilos instead of 35 kilos. That machine is going to make no difference. The answer lies somewhere else.
The large-scale collection and storage of biometric data puts the state in an extremely dominant position in relation to citizen. This tremendously enhances the state's ability to track an individual and engage in surveillance.
The first version of the Aadhaar Act, which is called the NIDAI Bill, which was shot down by the Parliamentary Standing Committee, as Reetika has explained, Section 8, which deals with authentication, made it very clear that authentication is just a yes-no answer. But in the final version of the Act, the requesting entity can request also your demographic information from the Aadhaar database. The only thing that is protected is what is called the core biometrics. Core biometrics as of now is basically fingerprints and iris scan. That is not to be shared with anyone. It's supposed to be absolutely safe. And whenever UIDAI responds to worries about data breach and privacy and so on, they keep saying your data is safe, your data is safe. All they mean by that is your core biometrics are safe. The rest is not safe. It's not meant to be safe. The Aadhaar Act is not meant to protect your data. It's a framework for sharing your data.
Oh, Facebook, Google and Amazon are doing it, so why didn't you make a fuss when they are doing it? Why are you going after Aadhaar? And my response to that is that if your house has been burgled, are you in the future going to sleep with your doors and windows open, or are you going to put better locks? Yeah, and when the government says when Facebook and Google are doing it, let us also do it, it's basically telling us that just abhi sab gaya, abhi just just forget it.
The idea of debating the role of the state in society is particularly important in today's context. the state through one of its arms or other is consistently telling us what to eat, what to watch, what to speak about, whom to pray to, even whom to marry. Dissent against state-sponsored views is sneered down upon and frequently met with violence. Indeed, I am concerned that we have allowed a school of thought to take control in India which believes that everything can be solved by violence, and that is always better to have power concentrated in a few or one or two people.
In 2010, there were only five of us who were whining away. I think there are many more people, including people who initially thought it was a great idea, who are now beginning to understand that this is not such a good thing. Unfortunately, Congress party and other political parties are not getting this message. Any political party today, if they say anything against Aadhaar, the media and whoever else, I don't know, will immediately label those parties as Luddites, they are backward looking, we should look ahead and technology is the answer and so on and so forth. Even those people might be saying this technology is good here and not good there. That part, of course, that there's no space for that kind of nuance in this mainstream debate.
Aadhaar makes the citizen transparent to the state, but makes the state completely opaque and unaccountable to its citizens.
The rhetoric is voluntary, consent, empowerment, and the reality for poor people is the absolute opposite. It's compulsory, there's no consent, and it's basically mostly disempowerment.
It would be right to say that this issue of digital identity is extremely complex, with views split down the middle. One view believes that that the unique identity is precisely the thing that our country needs in order to navigate through the 21st century, because it apparently will help transform the lives of impoverished millions. This is the view that has been effectively endorsed by the Supreme Court of India in upholding the law around Aadhaar. Another view, which even in the Supreme Court was relegated to a minority, is that Aadhaar has done nothing to help the impoverished, and indeed has only brought about exclusion, depriving millions of deserving persons from their right to due. This exclusion of powerless electorate is facilitated by unnecessary profiling through the collection of sensitive biometric and demographic data and the creation of a surveillance state, which in turn violates our fundamental right of privacy. The temptation to quote Orwell in this noisy debate is irresistible. I wonder if he was portending the modern Indian debate when he wrote in 1984, and I paraphrase, "Being in a minority, even in a minority of one, does not make you mad. There is truth and there is untruth. And if you cling to the truth, even against the whole world, you are not mad."